Professor Akinwande Oluwole Soyinka. Can I have the song now? Can I have the song? I ordered this song specially for you. Chancellor, sir, this is a citation. This is a citation. Before I give the citation, I would like to call upon Mrs. Forake Soyinka. Emeritus Professor Akinwande Oluwole Soyinka, poet, playwright, novelist, compelling essayist, director, road marshal, hunter, connoisseur of wine, activist, diplomat of moral courage. It has been noted that this particular honorary doctorate degree was originally awarded in 1987. That was 27 years ago, 1 year after his winning the Nobel Prize for Literature. This is due season. For like vintage wine, the longer it takes, the sweeter and the better. Not many celebrated icons in Nigeria have achieved so much in terms of global recognition on account of outstanding literary output as well as patriotic sacrifice as Professor Akinwande Oluwole Soyinka. Born on Friday, July 13, 1934, Soyinka began his academic journey at St. Peter's Primary School, Ake, in Abeokuta, at age of 3. He gained admission on scholarship into the renowned Government College Ibadan, GCI, and proceeded to University College Ibadan, UCI, and later on to the University of Leeds, where he bagged his BA degree. From 1958 to 1959, he worked as a dramatist at the Royal Court Theatre in London. He returned to Nigeria in 1960 and founded the famous theatre group, the 1960 Mask. In 1964, he also founded the Orison Theatre Company, on which platform he produced some of his written plays. This included The Swamp Dwellers and The Lion and the Jewel, which were performed in Ibadan in 1958 and 1959 respectively, and were published later in 1963. Shortly after his return from England, he took up an appointment as a research fellow in drama from 1960 to 1961. Between 1961 and 1967, Soyinka established himself as a major African playwright as well as academic. He held the position of lecturer in English at the University of Ife, 1962 to 1963, and in 1965, he was appointed as senior lecturer in English at the University of Lagos, where he subsequently became head of department. He was appointed as the first African director of the University of Ibadan School of Drama in 1867. Soon after then, he was arrested in August of the same year for his pacifist activities to stop the Nigerian Biafran War. He was jailed by the Nigerian authorities for 28 months and 22 days, most of which he spent in solitary confinement. After his release in October 1969, Soyinka returned to the University of Ibadan and took up the headship of the newly established Department of Theatre Arts. Soyinka left Ibadan in 1972 and was appointed later at the University of Ife as Professor of Comparative Literature in 1975. He retired from Ife in 1985. As a writer, his fame attained global and legendary status when he became not only the first African, but the first black person anywhere in the world to win the world's most coveted prize for literary achievement, the Nobel Prize in 1986. Emeritus Professor Oluwole Akinwande Soyinka has been described as a consistently courageous voice for human rights world over and a force in national politics. He is both prolific and profound. At the last count, between A Dance of the Forest, 1960, and Alakpata Akpata, 2011, and Harmattan Haze on an African Spring, 2012, Professor Soyinka has published over 40 titles in the major literary forms and some genres, including prose, poetry, drama, translation, and film. The body of his writings speaks truth to power and grips tyranny. To recall three chapters of the notes, line for line, word for word. The narrative concluded the story, concluded that when he later found the lost notes and compared, it was like a photocopy. His significance is global and local. So we shall say his significance is global. At the last count, WS has to his credit over 100 national and international awards, prizes, trophies, inductions, decorations in 5 continents: Africa, Asia, Europe, North America, South America. I cannot capture them all in just one brief breath, but suffice to refer to one of those symbolic gestures in honor of Professor Soyinka. By a special legal pronouncement on November 4, 2003, the Council of the City of New Orleans, U.S., unanimously agreed to honor and immortalize Wole Soyinka by declaring November 4, every year, as Wole Soyinka Day. As you can see, that is my dilemma, and that is where the story stops. To put it simply, without metaphors, Wole Soyinka is Wole Soyinka. Chancellor, if it is to cite and recite the profile and accolade of Wole Soyinka, let me refer to the title of one of Professor Karim Baba's books, which itself is a borrower from the repertoire of my Yoruba poetic lore. If it is about Wole Soyinka, I can speak until tomorrow. But am I permitted to tell the story of Akinwande in prose? Am I permitted to raise a million metaphors in praise of a man who has blazed so many trails, fought many fights against injustice, against all kinds of dictatorship, a man who, by writing in all the major journals of literature as out Shakespeare'd Shakespeare. So let me speak not in prose, graphically, of Wolesho Yinka in three pentameters. Okunrin, Ogun, Eni, Ogun, Ogun's incarnate and votary. Eni Ogun, pacifist warrior. Eni Ogun, Ogun statesman of Ijegba extraction. Olohun Iyo, the one whose mellifluous voice captured the attention of a continent. Kongi, Kako, Kapun, Father Courage, compound of spells. The personification of Invictus, the unconquered and unconquerable energy, spirit in the face of adversity and tyranny. At 80 years, 4 months and 5 days today, Professor Wolesho Yinka borrows the tongue of the Abiku child, coming and going these several seasons, but insisting that his country's chains shall not be charmed circles at his feet, in quest of excellence and justice. In reference to the quality of man and moral courage, the words of Martin Luther King becomes apt. The ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he stands at the time of challenge and controversy. In classical times, Aristotle said of the statesman, what the statesman is most anxious to produce is a certain moral character in his fellow citizens, namely, a disposition to virtue and the performance of virtuous actions. Apart from his identity as a scholar, Wolesho Yinka is equally a patriot and an elder statesman in the pure and antiseptic definition of the terms elder and statesman. He has been engaged with the fate of the Nigerian nation as a faithful, implacable, and inveterate critic of all kinds of tyranny in high and low places since Nigeria's independence in 1960 till present time. To show Yinka himself, under a dictatorship, a nation ceases to exist. All that remains is a fiefdom, a planet of slaves regimented by aliens from outer space. Chancellor, sir, ladies and gentlemen, this is Emeritus Professor Wolesho Yinka, simply WS. This is our salutation to his gods, the horseman of fluent and confounding words, the one who has been the interpreter of the open soul of a continent. He who set forth at dawn from Make through Apataganga, Ibadan to Leeds, becoming the toast of the world, of literary pundits and other philosophers. Always, always on the road, in the forest, and even as a swamp dweller, he has engaged giants and rodents, the Brother Jeros and the King Babus of this world. One of the original strong breeds, he has challenged both madmen and specialists in the season of anomy. His life is tied to the burden of memory. To those who have caused him the pain to write prison notes, Shoinka has been the muse of forgiveness. He is the shuttle in the crypt, the camwood on the leaves, courage in the climate of fear, the scourge of hyacinths and demons and fake futurologists. He is the interventions, outrage against prodigals and prostitutes of power. He is the one who always insists that the man dies in all who keep silent in the face of tyranny. In any people that submit willingly to the daily humiliation of fear, the man dies. Before our very eyes and in his own life, this is the beatification of WS. His homecoming trophy is finally here for the taking. Today, Wolesho Yinka, the lion, claims the jewel in his own habit.
Restoration, the ultimate responsibility. And I reminded us on that day that in the United States, as far back as 1957, in the very heartland of bigotry and intolerance of a different kind called racism, in a throwback state, where the lynching of our kind, blacks, was a kind of Sunday sport. The president of that nation federalized the National Guard and ordered that force to protect a young girl and establish on its soil equality of access to knowledge as the very foundation of the human community. Day after day, to the apoplectic jeering of the redneck residents of Little Rock, reinforced, of course, by the Ku Klux Klan, and at immense cost to the nation, that young girl marched to school under state protection. Now, how can anyone fail to see the progression of that act? The progression from that level of institutionalized racism was a precedent that led inexorably to the enthronement of a black man, a man of African descent, as the president of the most powerful nation in the world. Let me do all this. So, what is the difference between the Nigerian Boko Haram and the American night and day riders of hate and destruction? Slaves were not allowed to be educated in the States. You were lynched, hanged, castrated if you were caught with a book, even the Bible. As a black man, in those days we're speaking of in the States, to be caught even with a religious book was a crime for which you could be lynched. You had to receive whatever was allowed to trickle down to you for what is supposed to be the book, the holy book. So what's the difference between Boko Haram and the hooded agents of destruction, of black haters, the Ku Klux Klan? There's none. None whatsoever. Both thrive on hate. Both thrive on intimidation and the inculcation of fear. Both are divisive of society. Intolerance, intolerant of tolerance. Both divide humanity into the anointed and the damned, the visible and the should-be invisible, into Brahmins and untouchables. Both parrot tedious clichés, the play on emotionalism and short-time privileges. Both believe in terror, and both designate as first-line enemies those whom they consider traitors to their own sects, for accommodating those they have decreed rebellious slaves. Dear colleagues, just what is happening to our institutions of learning, especially in the northern part of this nation? What has happened to our faculty of reason and our knowledge of history when attempts are made to equate crude, deluded psychopaths with principled intercessionaries of change and authentic paracletes of societal revolution? What sort of revolutionaries do we have who tried to describe them as fighters for justice? Why do we debase words? Fighters for justice, and yet fighters against the basis of the mind, which is knowledge and enlightenment. Sciences, humanities, technology, social sciences, the arts, whatever, we're dealing with a monstrosity that repudiates even the pursuit of all these agents towards the enlightenment, the enlargement of the mind. Where, I asked at the time, was the University of Maiduguri? What was happening to it, I said? Did we send the children there to be educated, or to have their hands tied behind their backs and their throats slit together with their teachers? And yet we had a leadership which kept saying, oh, please talk to us, let us negotiate, talk to us, what do you want, what is it you need, we will supply it to you, come to the table, if you've been offended, we'll try and make amends, please forgive and forget. And yet our children's throats were being slit even at that time. So where is Maiduguri? Where are the children of Chibok? What crime did they commit? What crime have we committed that we allow them to humiliate us by their very absence, by their degradation, by their violation, by their disorientated? This is not what our children deserve. Let's all bear in mind that it all begins somewhere. It begins in failure to respond. In failure to respond as the president, that president of the United States did nearly half a century ago when he sent in the Federated National Guard and said, accompany that little girl to school and stay there until she completes her education. I said, I will not make this a gloomy day. I want to end on a positive note. In process right now is an organization called the Chibok Volunteer International. The idea of such a formation is to assist those whom have failed and also to intensify the form of education that will make such crimes against humanity impossible. To rescue, to bring back to the bosom of humanity those who were deluded sufficiently to believe that it's only by destroying enlightenment, education, institutions, that they will obtain the passport to paradise. To educate those who are educable and to destroy those who want to destroy our civilization, our sources of enlightenment, our belief in a common humanity, our egalitarian approach to the sexes, to humanity, respect for age, our commitment to the protection of the vulnerable, and our will, who want to destroy, undermine our will to rectify such atrocities in society and to bring them to book those who have created this cloud under which we gather here today and very rightly celebrate and take joy in ourselves, in our community of learning. I invite you, when eventually this organization, which will be made up of so many branches, medical, psychology, because many of these children, and we're not talking just about the Chibok girls, we use the word Chibok, it's become almost a symbolic word. It's for everything, virtually, that has gone wrong in this society. Sooner or later, this nation will recover itself sufficiently to raise a statue, a monument to the missing children, to ensure that we do not forget. And that we have just one mission, through enlightenment, to fuse humanity together, not to wallow in the mush that results from its destruction. I hope my fellow honorees will forgive me. I'm supposed to speak on behalf of all of you, but I can only trust that you share my views. And my friend, Madam Shekarau, take that message back to the man you are representing. That if we had genuine leadership, we would not be in this mess today. My friend, he's run away. He knows I was going to deal with him. I find myself on the platform with what they call barons of industry. And I'm glad you bring them in so they do not forget their beginnings. They shouldn't spend all their time and money on football. Soccer. We want them to be more proactive with universities and cultural institutions. We can't do without them, we know. But there's nothing evil about money, as long as it's used in the right cause. He's run away, but his assistant said, take that message back to him, that he's given enough to football, soccer. It's about time he came back to his roots, education, enlightenment. My friends, it's been a very long journey back here, back to this place. But I'm glad that I was able to make it. And I'm very glad that I was invited here. And I'm sorry that it took so long. I'm back now. I can call on me. I'm sure you can call on all of us here anytime that you require our collaboration. Thank you for this honor. Thank you very much. God bless everybody.